under pressure. Shasari re mi kufuka ne kuari.
Warm welcome to this webinar that Chisimani is hosting. This is the first of a series of three episodes that we are conducting because a big theme for us this year is migration and the political aspects of migration and immigration, which is a big theme from all over the world. And I'm here with two colleagues that I'll introduce a little bit after my introduction, Nicholas Maypole, and Kuduwashe, who are both from the African Center for Migration Studies at Wits University. And they've asked me to state at the top that there was a bit of a scramble for panelists. We had two other people secured and at the last minute they couldn't come. And so we're very grateful for both of them for being here. And I certainly, judging from their bios, don't think that they're going to be in the back foot on this topic in any way. So I'll introduce them a bit later. I just want to do a little bit of a framing for what are we doing here and why are we doing it and what this series is about. So this is episode one about borders and migration, and we've called it tightening border and militarizing immigration. And is this a solution or a threat? And so human migration has been seen as one of the defining issues of the 21st century. And along with this has become a global rise of the right all over the world, with the attendant problems of xenophobia and national politics and the violence, war, and politics of fear and exclusion. And so more than ever in the world, we are seeing a heightened rise of authoritarianism, and with that, the rise of walls and barriers as quick fixes to what is conventionally called an immigration crisis. And of course, you saw this in Trump's America. We see this in Hungary, where the first wall in Europe was built. And South Africa is no stranger to this either. So in March last year, over 40 million rand of taxpayers' money was spent on a fence between Zimbabwe and South Africa as a reaction to keep COVID-19 out of South Africa. Well, that was one of the reasons given. But as several authors have pointed out, this money could have more usefully been used to secure and roll out vaccines and to assist with a coordinated regional response to the pandemic. But instead, 40 million rand of resources was diverted to a fence that does not and cannot stop the movement of people across our borders. And then in December, images of thousands of people and trucks waiting in long queues at some of the busiest borders in South Africa with neighboring countries caused not only a terrible humanitarian crisis, but renewed calls for tightening our borders and amplified the voices of those who rally behind right-wing and conservative campaigns such as hashtag Put South Africa First. And over the years, South African government has responded to these calls by adopting a raft of measures that effectively militarize and securitize immigration, as well as criminalize migrants. And so many migrants, as we know, are caught in very desperate situations as coronavirus-related requirements now have made entry into South Africa even more difficult. And so for this webinar, our overarching question is, Does the government's border response offer real or sustainable solutions to the socio-economic and now health crisis gripping the country? And also, what does our government's increased response in terms of surveillance and securitization of migrants mean for ordinary South Africans and people? And just as a way into this, and stemming from the humanitarian crisis in December, we're now going to show a clip of two brief news items from the December Christmas period up to Christmas, where the humanitarian crisis evolved on the Beitbridge border at Messina. And the numbers aren't confirmed, but it seems that up to 15 people died trying to cross the border due to the uncoordinated COVID conditions, lockdown in Zimbabwe, level 3 in South Africa, and it seems the total unpreparedness of the border authorities, which left thousands of trucks and people queuing for days without food and water. So just as an intro, and before I introduce our panelists, can I ask Mo to please cue the video?
As we're headlining, three drivers have now died while waiting at the busy Beitbridge border post. Traffic at the post with Zimbabwe has been at a standstill for over 5 days now. At least 11 other people dying earlier this week while waiting to get into Zimbabwe. I want to talk now to Gavin Kelly, who's the Chief Executive Officer of the Road Freight Association, who is obviously watching the situation, I imagine, with a great deal of concern. Three more unnecessary deaths. Gavin, good afternoon to you. What were the circumstances?
Good afternoon, Jeremy. And unfortunately, I'm going to have to correct you. It's now four. And the circumstances are just this, that trucks are standing in queues that are 20 kilometers long on either side of the border. The guys are sitting in their trucks because they can't leave them for a number of reasons. First of all, is they don't want to leave the trucks unattended. Secondly, if they leave their truck, then somebody will take their place. So temperatures on those trucks are something like 43, 44 degrees. The guys don't have access to water, they don't have access to food, and of course there are no toilets or ablutions. It's a pitiful state of affairs.
Surely this situation could have been foreseen.
Well, Jeremy, you're using a word surely. You know, sitting right here, I cannot believe what's happening. We know that every year, Beitbridge becomes a cluster point or a point where people try and get from South Africa up north to their countries. They've been working all year in South Africa, so Zambians, Zimbabweans, Malawians, you name them, all try and go through that border post. So we know that happens. We should be prepared for that. We know that COVID has hit us. We know that there are extra protocols. Some of the borders and the routes that transporters would have used, or buses and people going home would have used, have closed. Botswana, Mozambique, there are challenges. So we knew that there was going to be this massive amount of people going to Beitbridge. But government has failed us.
What should government have done?
Well, first of all, they knew about the protocols that are being implemented on their side, as well as the Zimbabwean side. So they should have taken some steps like you see happening around the rest of the world, where you move the screening processes away from the border to an area where there are facilities and toilets. So, for example, at the nearest town, you put on more staff to deal with this so you can get the vehicles to throw through after screening and you get people to move through that choke point as quickly and as easily as possible. We should have put...
That these people, died, yes.
Mr. Van Niel, speaking of fatalities, I understand you are saying only one died from inside here, but are you in a position, because we've been struggling to get confirmation from any official in terms of how many people, we just get reports from hawkers that are selling on the side of the road and the people who are queuing that they did indeed see several people dying. Are you able to give us a number in terms of the past 7 days or so? Do you know how many people might have died on the streets?
Well, we must be aware that these things are very fluid, and as I speak to you now, it's indicated there's one person who died inside the port. There were people who also died before even the congestion. Around the 14th of December, we already had two fatalities, and they are included in the numbers that were shared with us. What we could receive from authorities that are working directly with us is that the two that died on the 14th, there were another one that died on the 22nd, another two on the 23rd, and another one on the 24th. So we're talking about eight people that died over the...
Okay. Okay, thank you. So, I mean, these very short clips just zone in on that particular crisis. In the first one, we had somebody talking about the truck drivers and the unpreparedness of the border management. And in the other one, a person from Home Affairs basically saying only one person died in our port and kind of jettisoning the response. So on the one hand, there's a level of unpreparedness that it seems. And on the other, it seems that there's an increased securitization, surveillance and militarization of the border. So to talk about these questions, we are joined firstly by Nicholas Maple from the Center for Migration Studies at BITS. And just to give a very brief intro to Nicholas before I hand over to him. Nicholas is a postdoctoral researcher at the ACMS at BITS, and his current work is on urban displacement, protection and mobility in sub-Saharan Africa. And in addition, he's involved in projects looking at the impact of COVID-19 on migrants and refugees on the continent. And his research has focused on Southern Africa, looking at the relationship between refugee camps, settlements, and urban displacement of refugees. And he has also worked as an advocate for refugee-based organizations such as Asylum Access and the UNHCR. And before I do hand over to Nicholas, I just want to talk about the structure of this afternoon. Nicholas is going to talk for about 10 minutes. I'll then introduce Kudakwashe and his biography. And then Nicholas is going to address one of the core questions, and then we will start with some questions. For audience on Facebook as well as on Zoom, please use the Q&A or the chat function to pose questions that we will take towards the second half of the seminar. So Nicholas, can I give over to you? Thank you very much.
Thanks, Alex. Let me just share my screen. Sorry. Is that working? I think that's working. Cool. Hi, Orwin. Thanks to Alex for the invitation. As you mentioned, my background is in refugee reception and protection, particularly looking at refugee camps and urban displacement. But for today, my colleague Huda and I will speak about this idea of tightening borders and securitizing immigration. Next slide. So our plan is for me to speak a little to the notion of security and immigration in the context of South Africa. Nkuda is going to speak to his research at the South African and Zimbabwean border, and also touch on some of the recent ACMS research that we've been conducting, looking at state-based responses to COVID-19 and these responses' impact on migrants and refugees. I'll then finish off by bringing up a few points about why these issues, especially in relation to xenophobic violence, should matter to us all. And if you have any questions, you're happy to answer them at the end. Okay, so security issues have long been discussed in reference to state responses to refugee and migrant movement in Southern Africa, and particularly so in relation to South Africa. The concept itself, though, security, is often ill-defined or used broadly to cover a multitude of issues, such as the infiltration of soldiers into refugee populations or the risk of increased crime in urban spaces. So I think a helpful way to gain a clearer understanding of how security plays a role in cross-border migration is to make a distinction between direct security concerns, indirect security concerns, and this notion of securitization. So firstly, direct security concerns. These are those that relate to who is coming into a host country. Indeed, numerous security issues can potentially arise when migrants or refugees cross a border. This is particularly the case in the situations of mass influx. So for example, when you have hundreds of thousands of people crossing a border due to conflict or say economic collapse. In times of conflict, armed elements may be able to infiltrate a refugee camp. So for example, this is a situation where influx of Somali refugees in northern Kenya since the early 90s have been on occasions infiltrated by Somali armed factions. Sorry. In contrast, indirect security concerns refer to increased levels of insecurity or crime within the areas that migrants or refugees may settle. In terms of evidence to support these fears, it's clear that insecurity can arise when large numbers of migrants arrive en masse in urban areas. Tensions often revolve around competition for employment, health, and education, and can be particularly noticeable over the short term. However, over the long term, there appears to be a broad consensus that any negative or most negative short-term effects impacting, say, the labour market are eventually reversed. Okay, so these two first two categories, direct and indirect security concerns, are valuable as they can help us identify genuine security issues facing host states. This is in contrast to the idea of political securitization agendas that target migrant movements in order to justify restrictive migration policies and or to scapegoat migrants and refugees for other issues. This securitization of migration refers to the conception of migration as a security threat to a state or a society. Indeed, states and the media are increasingly viewing or portraying the movement of refugees and most forms of migrants as a threat to national security. By framing migrants and their movement as a security concern, the issue becomes urgent and essential. This means that an issue that is called a security threat does not need to be substantiated or even evidence-based. Migrants become others, people deemed to be a threat to the security and identity of a local population. As suggested, this approach then creates the justification for more restrictive policies against migrants, as well as greater surveillance, detention, and even deportation. In turn, this forces migrants to use more dangerous routes when traveling, as well as using smugglers to reach their intended destination. Securitization of migration also contributes to the growing anti-migrant tendencies within local populations, such as the rising levels of xenophobia seen in South Africa. So, turning to South Africa specifically, over the last decade or so, there's been a marked shift within key government departments on how to approach migrants and refugees. Specifically, the language of security is now filtering into all aspects of national policy. The increased movement of refugees and other migrants into South Africa has only intensified and developed this security lens further still. For example, the Department of Home Affairs has adopted an increasingly simplistic discourse in relation to asylum seekers. By using the idea that people are abusing the system, the discourse essentially sees all individuals in the asylum system as illegitimate claimants and illegal migrants. And just to point on that, I think it's vital to be aware of the power of language and labels. By continually referring to migrants and refugees as illegal, this is essentially devaluing these people. Equally, there's really no such thing as an illegal person. So other terms such as undocumented or irregular migrants are perhaps better terms to use when we're discussing these situations, even though then I'm not entirely sure these sort of terms are ideal. Okay, going back to the approaches by South Africa to migration. Recent proposals have also suggested whole of government and whole of society approaches to international migration. In theory, this is quite a progressive development, yet there appears the risk that any new whole of society approach would in fact narrow protection for migrants and refugees. For example, proposals include multiple government institutions and private and state-run organizations, such as banks and schools and hospitals, becoming more involved in the daily management of migration. Thus, there is a suggestion that these approaches could simply be attempts at internalizing migration controls via better coordination between government departments, private service providers, and potential employers. Finally, you can also see this language of security directed towards migrants at the city level. For example, with the previous Johannesburg mayor, Mashaba, after he came into power, there was this marked increase in the securitization of all foreign African nationals and the insertion of xenophobic sentiments into public speeches and policy. Indeed, a key message from the mayor's office was the blaming of structural and systematic issues within the city, such as crime, a lack of jobs, and a lack of housing on other African migrants and refugees. An illustration of this comes from an infamous speech covering cross-border migrants given by the mayor in 2017. In it, he noted, "They're holding our country to ransom, and I'm going to be the last South African to allow it. I've got constraints as local government because the national government has opened our borders to criminality." I was going to stop there, Alex, if that's okay, and Kuda's going to take over and talk about the borders between Zimbabwe and South Africa.
Okay. Do you want to stop sharing?
Yeah, sorry.
I just want to introduce Kuda quickly because I haven't done so yet. Kudakwashe Vanyoro is also a postdoctoral research fellow at the African Center for Migration and Society at Wits University, and he specializes in migration, borders, humanitarianism, and governance in Africa. And his research has explored how disruptions at international borders shape immigrants' experiences and modes of waiting. The research focused on irregular Zimbabwean men at the Zimbabwean-South African border who have arrived in South Africa but are restricted in moving further into the interior. And this research reveals how waiting is a component of both governing Zimbabwean migrants, as well as seeking agency through the relationship between time, space, and humanitarianism in the Zimbabwe-South Africa border regime. So thank you, Kudakwashe. Can I hand over to you to speak to your area of the topic? Thank you.
Excellent. Thanks a lot, Alex, for the opportunity. And thanks, Nick, for setting the ground for this discussion. I'd like to maybe begin by going back to the introduction that has been made in reference to the festive season of last year, in which we saw migrants in their thousands at border posts between South Africa and its neighbors. And mostly this has been, as we saw in the news clips, was attributed to a lack of coordination between governments and also the failure to implement strategies that the SADC member states had agreed on. And we know that, as a matter of fact, that a Zimbabwean citizen died after collapsing near the Beitbridge border after she complained of fatigue and feeling dizzy while waiting in a bus. And altogether, as has already been established, at least 15 people reportedly died in these delays. And going back to the diagnosis that has been offered, many would like to argue that high-level talks and use of the SADC guidelines on the pandemic should have been used to prevent a crisis. But in my view, I do think that there is really nothing new about this neglect, or perhaps to even look at it differently, there isn't really anything new to the lack of sort of political will in that space for the state to the bureaucratic state to intervene or to offer some kind of support. So it's quite easy to think of these developments as perhaps some kind of oversight. But I think that we are seeing more how immobility is proliferating as a component in its own of governing the Zimbabwe-South Africa border. So we can think of, in my perspective, of some of this neglect as in itself an element of governance. Because governance is not necessarily the presence of sort of policies or institutions. It also refers to, I think, the absence. So it is not by any mistake that we should think about what is happening in that border. And this governance mainly applies in the case of the research I've done to Zimbabwean migrants whose immobility is mainly characterized by challenges that make it indesirable for them to return to Zimbabwe, as well as difficult to move forward into the country or invest in South Africa, that is, or invest in any future elsewhere. And I think that there's a particular unfolding that is important for understanding of this border and this transformation in relation to attended crisis. I already have heard the term humanitarian crisis coming up here. And in my view, the humanitarian crisis and immobilities have become somewhat bureaucratized at this border. And we need to go back to as far as 2000, about a decade ago, which is around 2007, 2008, when Messina, which is the border town between Zimbabwe and South Africa that is situated around 15 kilometers or so from the border, was cast into the public eye in the wake of the Zimbabwean economic crisis because of its unique location. And I think in one of the clips we saw a reference being made to how perhaps it would be useful to use the town as a proxy to try and manage or set up institutions for dealing with the crisis. So it is the Zimbabwean economic and political situation that in the first place led to a humanitarian influx to an influx to Messina by thousands of desperate Zimbabweans. But this was also accompanied by the opening up of field offices for many a humanitarian actor, including the United Nations, the UNHCR and the IOM. And it was around the same time, I think in 2008, that the mayor at Caroline Mahasela admitted that the steady flow of people in the town was putting pressure on the municipality's resources. And in some ways, the migration was testing South Africa's legal and institutional structure for managing migration and protecting refugees. So many of these migrants began bathing and staying in the surrounding areas of what was called the Messina Showground Camp, as they did not have anywhere to go, until 2009, when authorities forcibly expelled thousands of them as the Department of Home Affairs ordered them to close down all semi-permanent structures. And this is around the time when many Zimbabweans then began to flee from this border area to Johannesburg, with many heading to Bishop Paul Verin's Central Methodist Church with the help of many humanitarian organizations, although others remained in Messina or would simply return to Messina upon being deported with even more pressing needs that the state would be unable to fulfill. So coupled with this lack of government assistance, there was a concerted humanitarian response from the UN, which opened the field offices in 2008. The IOM also came in, and a number of faith-based organizations established what they call transit shelters to accommodate children, men and women who were stuck in Messina, creating a regime for managing these migrants according to these categories. These shelters were initially set up to hold these irregular migrants for no more than 72 hours, but this was later extended to 2 weeks to offer them protection while they waited for their asylum papers, excuse me. So in this space, there was a differentiation that would take place between Zimbabweans, Burundian and Congolese asylum seekers. But what we're seeing now is that with the shift in the crisis in Zimbabwe, or the demise of Robert Mugabe, that has been accompanied by a shift in how the South African state and also how the UN perceives and reads the Zimbabwean migrants as anything other than asylum seekers. So they're predominantly called economic migrants. So they're now staying in these shelters indefinitely while trying to raise money for transport to travel further south without any kind of humanitarian support. And at the shelter for men in particular, migrants have to stay under crowded and unsanitary conditions, receiving no meals. They have to fend for themselves. They have to observe a curfew in which they have to leave at 6 a.m. and arrive back in by 6 p.m. to do whatever jobs that they can find. But this is compounded by the fact that they cannot leave the vicinity of the shelter or they risk being arrested and deported. So according to the agreement between the sort of local enforcers of the law and the shelters, these migrants can only stay there without documentation for as long as they don't leave the shelter. And access to water is also contested, and their livelihoods and future horizons are largely disrupted. So I'd like to maybe use this case in closing to draw attention to how these forms of governed immobility and containment are not only a microcosm of wider experiences of migrants and borders and across communities in all regions of the African continent. But I think even the daily realities we have been seeing and complaining about in, with regards to COVID-19 lockdowns. In other words, restrictions on movement have also become somewhat the norm as they are for these migrants, although we can always talk about the difference in degree. And we found this to be the case in a recent study we've been working on for the African Commission, which looked at the effect of state responses to COVID-19 on migrants, refugees, and internally displaced persons in the African Union. These responses largely restrict internal movements and lock down and close down borders. And they are surely going to be felt for a long term, particularly for those working in the informal economy who lack any job security, protection, and experience exploitation with little social safety nets to work with. In this way, COVID-19 and resulting lockdown measures have affected the poor and marginalized within states, regardless of citizenship or legal status. And much like everyday life in this border zone, the response to COVID-19 has provided states with opportunities to limit the movement of people across borders and justify restrictive approaches to managing migration. Yet we know for a fact that these fortifications do not stop movement. If anything, they are only pushing migrants into more dangerous situations. And the COVID-19 responses that are legitimizing increasingly securitized response to immigration mean that the pandemic is only a convenient framing to push certain state agendas and restrict immigration while appearing to do so through a humanitarian global health approach. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Can I just, before I hand back to Nicholas, can I just ask you one question quickly, just for clarification, if you don't mind. When you talk about immobility, what do you mean by that?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think, and in some instances in writing, we don't really write of it as immobility as one word. Sometimes you have to kind of bracket the initial IM or put a slash after, removing the brackets, because we're really talking about sort of restrictions on movement within particular spaces. But we're also talking about movement that has to do, I think we're talking about people who have actually managed to move in the first place and then cannot move any further. Okay. But I think talking about mobilities as opposed to migration also allows us to talk about people who are facing challenges once they've arrived in a particular country, because we're not really talking about them crossing sort of cartographic or physical borders, but then having to cross through, maybe to use more some theoretical language around sort of the humanitarian borders or the internal categorizations that the state has resorted to. And then I think finally, besides the physical movement or movement in physical space, we're also talking about mobility within time or within people's aspirations. So social mobility, for example, is one way to look at this, because when people are not allowed to move within physical space, that means that their access to social mobility or the capital thereof that they need is also restricted. So we're also talking about stagnation, people's aspirations through restrictions on livelihoods and access to different forms of capital.
Okay. Thank you. That's great. Thanks so much. Okay, Nicholas, you wanted to close off. Thank you.
Sorry, I just wanted to finally end just on a question that Alex posed to us just before the event. It was essentially why South Africans should be interested in this topic, and what does this securitization immigration policy mean for activism and ordinary Southern South Africans? And I've been thinking about this over the last few days. I do think people in academia, well, some of us particularly, remain a little too removed perhaps from activism. So don't necessarily take the time to think about these sort of important questions. But I have a few thoughts which I thought I'd share, and then obviously very keen to listen to other people's views on these things. So first, I think there are clear and obvious human rights arguments based on the Constitution, but also arguments based on Pan-Africanism you can make regarding the poor treatment of African migrants and refugees. Secondly, these security approaches to migration also affect current efforts at the continental level, so this sort of AU level, but also at the regional, so here we're talking about Southern Africa level, to push through freedom of movement for all persons on the continent and within the region. Meaning these security approaches affect all South Africans in their ability to work and travel in other countries in Africa. Third, our colleague at ACMS, JP, has written a great deal on the impact of xenophobic violence and why we should all really care about it. And these points are beyond the sort of normative ideas of justice, compassion, and dignity. So, for example, xenophobic beliefs and violence go far beyond just attempting to drive immigrants out of South Africa. They also have negative socio-economic, political, and security implications for everyone. For example, the looting and destroying of spaza shops. These shops are often essential, not just for immigrants, but also community members. Locals then have to travel further to get products and often pay more for them in expensive malls. Also, these xenophobic leanings often tend to go further than just focusing on foreigners. Indeed, they regularly start to also focus on excluding other South Africans, with instigators saying areas or businesses are for locals only. To sort of localization arguments, thus making other South Africans become also outsiders within a community. The violence also affects the economy on a grander scale, with international investment affected. Furthermore, on the continent, the reputation of South Africa also suffers, with South African businesses often affected or even boycotted in countries such as Zambia and Malawi. Finally, these approaches, I think, also fuel the idea that politicians can get away with blaming migrants for numerous structural issues within the state. For example, the inability to deliver basic services. It is, of course, much easier to blame migrants than looking more closer to home for underlying issues such as corruption or a lack of funding. There were sort of my points, Alex, from reading your email. I'll leave it there, but keen to carry on the discussion and learn from everyone else. Thanks.
Thank you so much. Can I invite Kuda Kwashi also to put your screen on as well? And I'm just going to start off with one or two questions from myself before. I've noted one already that is in the chat that I've noted about children. But before that, I just wanted to maybe just summarize some of the thoughts I had. So for example, Nicholas, you talk about how this narrative that migrants are a threat then legitimizes, urgency to securitize. And I just wanted to notice, that there's a very similar connection to be made for activists, actually, who are, when they protest, are criminalized often. And that then legitimizes the use of rubber bullets, as an urgent response. And so there's something here about the state response that then legitimizes violence. You know, today there has been another person killed at a protest with a rubber bullet. But I just wanted to also make that connection about these narratives of who are threats and who is threatening to the South African state. Yakuda, you're talking about the securitized responses as well. I think what's quite important for us to understand as maybe an opening sort of question is we're talking quite generally about a securitized response. What are those responses? You know, I've heard about drones being used, track and trace under COVID for migrants in particular. There's a new border management agency. Could one of you just, you know, clearly spell out the ramping up of militarization? Because again, this affects activism. You know, if drones are legitimized as a way to track people, drones are also being used in protests now by the South African police to identify who the protesters are, you know, to criminalize further. So I'm wondering if you could just talk about the kind of materialities of what security and militarization means of our borders, just as an opening.
I can go, Kuda, first, if you like. Thank you, Alex. Your first point about securitization and threat, I think the work that people have done in the past on securitization isn't just purely migration. It sort of spans multiple subjects. From my own research, just as an example, I did a lot of research in Zambia, and it's interesting for various reasons, but I think for one reason, because refugees are essentially housed in refugee camps or settlements, refugees and foreign migrants aren't necessarily securitized. Well, they're not in the same way as South Africa does, mainly because of numbers, but other issues. What the government there is doing is securitizing other things like opposition parties or civil society. So the space for civil society in Zambia is reducing all the time, and other political parties. It's a massive, it's a whole field in itself, securitization, but that's the sort of thing that I, like you say, exactly with activism. In relation to borders, like a colleague has talked a lot about drones. I am not super familiar with that, so I wouldn't necessarily want to comment too much on that. From my area, the bits around refugee protection that I've noticed being in the last few years is a continual talk to create processing centers at the border in South Africa. So when refugees are currently, and tell me to stop if this becomes too much of about refugees, but when refugees cross the border in South Africa, compared to other states in Southern Africa, they in policy and law should have freedom of movement. What the government now is trying to do is, and I think through these processes of securitization, is remove refugees from cities to border areas. And so by creating what they would call processing centers, it's the idea of you're not granted freedom of movement until your application for refugee status is approved. I think in reality, what might happen if these sort of processing centers will happen is refugees and asylum seekers will continue to be removed from city and urban spaces, and you'll get either essentially sort of a quasi refugee camp or some sort of informal settlements at the border where refugees and other migrants won't be essentially about to leave. I think I'll stop there. Kuda, have you got some comments?
Thanks, Nick. I think that's very, very useful information there, Nick, around the externalization stuff, or like the moves towards externalizing borders, which is really already happening in North Africa in certain contexts such as Libya, where sort of European countries have all sorts of bilateral and multilateral agreements with these proxy North African states to keep people within their border areas, confined in there and contained, so that they're not able to move or to get onto the next boat or whatever it is that they would like to do. And what emerges there is you find sort of quasi-militarized camps or detention facilities that are difficult to access for humanitarian organizations because either they're run by the military or they've been outsourced to security, different security personnel. And I think we've heard a lot about how those sites then become even targets for bombings and for different reasons. But I mean, this is an example from North Africa, but that is where the refugee or the Border Management Act is moving the country towards. It's sort of that model of let's put borders out there, let's have processing centers outside the territory to avoid having spaces such as perhaps I think the transit shelters where, you know, you allow people to then come in to claim asylum, then they become your responsibility. But I think also to look at securitization, or perhaps more subtly as migration management in general, or categorizing and labeling certain people as a threat to accessing resources or to accessing welfare, or to dwell within a particular land in the name of sovereignty, because sovereignty is a key aspect of state security. So it is also about how these spaces allow different non-state actors to enforce and police migrants in very different subtle ways by labeling who deserves protection and who doesn't, right? So I see it broadly as not simply the physical threat, but also the more symbolic and expansive stuff that happens in the day-to-day interactions that these migrants have with state and non-state actors. And then the more direct forms, of course, that we know about is the stuff around the border fence that was erected. And we know that also there's a lot of militarization within the border. It's the border trail itself for those who are crossing the river, which also creates all sorts of risks for these migrants. So instead of protecting via military or police, you are in fact reproducing insecurity by trying to securitize, right? Because when people have to jump the border, they now have to pay smugglers who sometimes give them to the hands of maguma who are notorious for robbing and mugging. So it's a very ambivalent kind of context, but it in some ways serves to reinforce migrant insecurity.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm going to, there's already three opening questions through Facebook, so I'm just going to read the three out. And then between you, you can maybe figure out how or who wants to answer them. Okay, so the first one is from Facebook, from Melikai Yalwa. He said, I would like to ask whether what could be the best sustainable solutions to address the issue state security versus economic activities, such as free trade at SADC region and COVID-19 preventative measures. And if South Africa is welcome to everyone, what is the burden on the state in terms of resources such as healthcare and education? So that's kind of two questions of the first one. Then Shireen has asked, how did the South African government's response to COVID take into account people who are undocumented and stateless in South Africa? And then a side question is the report of the ACHPR that Kudakwashi referenced available to the public yet. So stateless and undocumented people, how has the COVID response? And then there was a question in the beginning about, and that was also directed to Kuda, was about children. You know, what are the implications for securitization and stuckness, or have you said as immobility for children of migrants? So those, can we start with those three? So the first was about sustainable solutions to state security, as well as the need for economic activity such as free trade and the burden on the South African state if there is free movement. Can we start maybe with that question? Who would like to address that?
I can give it a go, Kuda, if you want me to.
Thanks.
I mean, there's been quite a lot of pushes within SADC region to create these sort of free movement, free trade agreements within the region. But countries like South Africa and other sort of big players, I think it's like Botswana, they're the ones who have been pushing back and stopping it. So we have sort of draft protocols on the facilitation of free movement, which have never really moved past draft documents. So there's one point I would say is that South Africa has been sort of stopping those sort of movements within the region. Secondly, I wasn't quite sure the question. South Africa doesn't let everyone in. Like that, the Immigration Act is incredibly restrictive, particularly with in relation to high-skilled migrants. There are options, but for low-skilled migrants, it's incredibly difficult to get a visa to get into and work in formal markets within South Africa. So I would say that what happens then is the asylum system gets a little bit clogged up with people who don't have any other option but using that system. But I mean, I think the problem with that sort of narrative is then the blame gets put onto the individual migrant rather than the system, which is fundamentally flawed, this Migration Act and the migration system around it. So that would be, I mean, to me, freedom of movement and free trade within Southern Africa would be. I'm a fan. Like, I think that's where we should be heading towards. But I also see, as I mentioned in my opening comments, I do think perhaps sometimes we do forget there are genuine security issues and genuine insecurity, indirect security concerns within states. And I'm not sure anyone, well, I think some people would, but there is this discussion to be had around who is coming into your country, and those sort of genuine security concerns have to be considered, I think. That was my answer to the first one. In relation to the report on the African for the African Commission, it's ongoing, but we can share once things are public with you guys, so you can share with your members if that's helpful. In relation to undocumented and stateless persons in South Africa, during the last year or so, I mean, it's been pretty, like, effectively, there hasn't been much in the way of state responses to these sort of populations. The problem, as Kuda mentioned earlier, is a lot of the populations, these types of populations will work in the informal economy. And so as soon as you sort of start restricting movement, their income gets dried up. And that's why we saw a lot of return migration from South Africa to other states during that. There were some movements, and some organizations in South Africa did a really good job of getting some inclusion for grant money to certain refugee groups. But I'm not quite sure how it ended up, but my understanding was the implementation was pretty poor. The one of the more positive points was the extension of visas and refugee cards, but that was sort of done at a high level, and then implementation again on the ground, when people talk to police or immigration officers, it becomes a bit more complicated. I think I'll stop there for a sec. And
I think this question about the burden on the states, on the healthcare system and on the education system, for example, and jobs, so a lot of the narrative is about, South Africans have no jobs, and now we have migrants coming in and they're taking jobs. I mean, what is the evidence through that, and what is there's a perception of burden, and how does what is the evidence, and how that actually plays out in terms of the what is happening on the ground?
I mean, go on, Kuda.
I think we need to clear up a few, some of these myths around, for example, when it comes to the economy. Research that's been done to show how migrants contribute to the economy in terms of GDP, in terms of tax. There's a lot of work as well that's been done by organizations like SERI, showing how within informal, I think the GC art has done a lot of work to show, or some work to show how in the informal sectors, you know, a certain proportion of jobs is, you know, like a certain number is created per migrant. So they have tried to tally some of those contributions. So it's not really substantiated by empirical evidence that migrants do. It is a perception, and that migrants do take away employment. But I think when we look at the sort of the broader contribution to the economy, there is a wider evidence base to show to the contrary. I think the work that has also been done by the Migrating for Work Consortium has also tried to show this, and also some stats essay data that has been triangulated by different researchers. And when it comes to health, public health, we know for a fact that there is this knowledge we have about how people who actually move are most likely to be young and most likely to be healthy populations. So you will not find someone who's because the migration journey, as I've mentioned, is tasking, right? If you are going to be crossing through the border and having to survive and thrive within these shelters, you cannot be in a sort of poor state of health, right? So already there is what some kind of inherent selection that happens in terms of who is sort of predisposed to move. Populations who are sending communities mostly send out because mobility is, or migration is, an investment for communities. So that requires a lot of investment, and that investment within families at the decision-making stage is appropriated towards someone who is much healthier and much more likely to be able to work and take care of themselves, right? So that is some of the intuitiveness without even having to go into further data or anything of that sort that would show us or suggest to us that migrants are not necessarily and a lot of studies that show that migrants are not, or surveys that migrants are not moving to seek health. They are moving to seek work, to seek livelihoods. And then, of course, when they do fall sick, they would require the attention of the public healthcare system. And at the same time, within the context of COVID, we need then to think about how livelihoods and public health and also this so-called burden are intertwined, because if a society or a country that doesn't take care of its population, whether they document it or not, creates a public health burden on its own of communicable diseases, because, you know, whether you're a migrant or not, you are going to be having COVID-19, you are going to be having tuberculosis, for example, and you are going to be needing treatment. And migrants, after all, stay within communities. So if you do not get the necessary treatment, that means that you are going to be affecting or spreading some of that disease to surrounding communities, right? So one then needs to think about what kind of burden are we talking about when we don't treat migrants. Are we not reproducing a public health burden that will soon, or has already perhaps translated into an economic burden? Particularly, we know with the history of labor migration to the mines and South Africa's quadruple burden of disease, that there is already an interaction between mobility and public health. And if it's not properly attended to, you are only reproducing more issues for yourself. And then perhaps the last point I have to make about the whole notion of a burden has to do with how, if the country would be open to all, whatever form. I think if you were to document your people and whoever, you know, people who would like to move and have some sort of employment within their prospective country, you're more likely to be able to manage that mobility. You're more likely to manage what those people contribute to your economy, for example, where their taxes go. So it's only by formalizing and documenting people as a state that you would be able to draw the benefits of migration. And South Africa is not currently not doing a great job at that, because people move informally or irregularly through informal irregular means. They spend most of their money on smugglers or paying smugglers. So that money is going into the, to use, for lack of a better term, a black market. So you're basically losing out already before people even cross into your country on monies that could be going into mainstreaming or streamlining migration. For example, we know in Asia that there is, you know, bilateral agreements, or sometimes there are formal recruiters that work hand in hand with the state that accrue certain benefits to the state. So if you were to think critically, there are ways, you know, if you were to think as a statesman, there are ways that you can actually draw benefits from commodifying migration and mainstreaming it in one way or the other. Of course, we can always debate about ethics of doing that, but we cannot deny that there are benefits, more benefits than the current status quo. Thanks.
Thanks, that's really useful. I'm just encouraging our audience on Facebook, et cetera, as well as on this Zoom call to put questions and post questions as they come up. Just the last thing from this round was about children, you know, and yeah. The particular context of children of migrants, and if either of you could speak to that, and what does that mean in the context of COVID, securitization, etc.
I don't think I would have much to say about sort of children of migrants, but from my own work at the border, there is a shelter that exists that takes care of children. So there are shelters that do take care of children, and some, you know, differentiated according to gender. So boys have so unaccompanied minors, for example, have their own shelters for boys and shelters for girls. So there is some kind of support that is taking place at the border. From around the period of 2008, there was a lot of children that were being seen in the streets of Messina. My colleague Stanford Mahati did a whole sort of PhD project looking at some of these dynamics and what was happening around that time. But perhaps one thing to take home from this is that there are people who are moving. There are children who are moving voluntarily from countries such as Zimbabwe, for example, to come and seek work, who are legally sort of not necessarily adults, which I think the discussion about children had boils down to, you know, do we consider children vulnerable, and what do we get by referring to children as a vulnerable category? And in the South African case, there is a concerted effort to care for migrant children from humanitarian actors' point of view. Save the Children has been doing a lot of work in that border area, but also the state also has a sort of determination process for putting children under the care of these shelters. I'm not too clued up on these, some of these legal processes, but I know that the Department of Social Development provides some kind of monies for the care of children in these shelters. So for each child, you know, a shelter that's properly established receives a certain amount. So the South African state does try to look into the welfare of children in these border areas, and also that is also once some legal processes around guardianship and whatnot that I'm not clued up on do take place. So for me, perhaps the only discussion is the worthwhile discussion is, you know, whether talking about children as a vulnerable group benefits them necessarily in any way, because in Stanford's work, he was finding a lot of what he called independent children who perhaps the state would say, we want to return you to Zim, and they would say, you know, I don't want to go back to Zimbabwe. There actually is no one to take care of me. So I'm actually here on my own volition to find work. So perhaps that's the worthwhile discussion or the one notable contribution I gather from what I have experienced around this issue.
Just subject to what Kuda's just said, the only thing I would say is that when we were doing the research, looking at the impact of COVID, UN agencies were observing that there were more unaccompanied, what they would define as unaccompanied minors, crossing borders in Southern Africa at the later part of last year due to their understanding of the perceived need to cross borders to get work for family, to support family. But subject to what Kuda said about that sort of discussion around vulnerability. The only thing I did also want to mention quickly was I don't know if Kuda, just to mention this sort of idea, and ACMS has done a lot of work in the last 10, 15 years on this idea that the number of international migrants in South Africa is much smaller than what the sort of narrative is around migrants coming in, taking jobs, compared to, for example, internal migration into cities such as Johannesburg. The much larger number is internal migration than external. So, but yeah, there's lots of report. ACMS have done lots of work on that, so it's worth checking.
Great, thank you so much. Okay, so the next question is from my colleague Pindile, who is also asking something that I was furiously writing about. Now I've lost it. Here it is. and she says, I'm interested in exploring this idea of neglect as a mode of governance and policy choice, and also the politics of waiting. I can think of different ways and themes that run through the lives of ordinary South Africans. An example is how grant claimants are forced to wait for hours to access money, often arriving in the early hours of the morning. And we also saw how grant claimants with disabilities were sprayed with water. And I wonder if these realities provide a basis for activists to see what government does to migrants is also applicable to them. So that's quite an interesting provocation there from Pindi. And if either of you would like to respond about this idea of a governance of neglect as a policy,
I'm happy to respond to that. I think that's a very interesting contribution, particularly related to the research that I've been doing around these notions of immobility and temporal disruptions and and waiting as well. Yeah, it is. Pindile? I think you are right in actually saying that. These politics of waiting, we should rightly see these as actual modes of governance, because who is it that is forced to wait, right, is one question. And I think one of the question, when we look at the COVID-19 example, without necessarily going back to the organizing principle of migration, the people who were seeing waiting for services within urban spaces where actually the urban poor largely who stay in informal settlements that are already in themselves crowded and sometimes often characterized by a lack of service delivery. These are people who already have to wait for RDP houses and who now have to go and get a grant because of how society has dealt them. Society, which is in itself is sort of constituted along lines of race and class. But beyond that, it is about what happens when you're dealing with a pandemic that needs you to be distant from others, that you now must put yourself and your body at risk to go and stand in a particular space for something that you ought to have in an ideal in an ideal country, right? If you were not, you know, if possibly if you were born in Bulgaria, you wouldn't have to be in that kind of a situation. And not only are you waiting for in close proximity, you're also waiting for long hours, whereas the COVID-19 protocol suggests you shouldn't be doing that. You should be out of a particular space within the maximum cap of 2 hours, to say the least, right? So yeah, it is very important that we look at how the state has, wittingly or not, reproduced these inequalities. So and this is something that our research was finding around migration, that COVID has only served to heighten and magnify and pay and actually zero into these inequalities that we already know exist. There are scholars who then argue that there is a political economy that is linked to who it is that is forced to wait. It's not, you don't just wait out of the blue, you wait because you have, you know, someone has to provide a particular service that you don't have. So yeah, it's an interesting area of research, and it's an area of research that is also starting to gain traction both globally and hopefully within our own context. We'll have more people like Pindile who are keen in looking at these issues beyond just seeing waiting people as just people who are doing nothing. There is more to it to that as well.
Great, thank you.
I would only just to slightly add on that, just around refugees and asylum seekers. I think there are people who have made the argument that the environment is deliberately hostile towards them, as in the intention is for it to become so hard that people will leave, like they don't, you know, and so this around this idea of sort of a hostile environment. And I think you can see the result of that within sort of the protests in Cape Town in the last few years with refugees saying it's not safe anymore or it's not viable to live in South Africa. But that was just sort of a follow-on point.
Okay. Are there any more questions via Facebook or Zoom? I know we have people from refugee and immigrant communities on this call, so I'd love one of them maybe to comment. If they want to, or to raise their hand, or to ask a question. Mo, is somebody able to ask their question by unmuting? But if so,
yes, try. They just need to raise their hand.
Okay, they just need to raise their hand. So if anyone, Joe Eve or Isaiah, I know you're both on this call, if you have anything that you'd like to ask, we'd love to hear from the immigrant community, as well as any of the activists that we work with. But while I wait for that, actually this comes from a conversation we had with Joe Eve. One of the questions I also want to think about is our region, you know, and this idea that SADC is meant to be working regionally, it clearly isn't, and that has impact on border management. And so we know at the moment there is really, really worrying things happening in Mozambique. We know that there has been major political instability in Zimbabwe, et cetera. You know, what do you think the South African government's, to what extent is the South African government complicit in some of the political instability, or will foreign policy contribute to desperate people fleeing in terms of maybe inaction? So this is a kind of foreign policy question, I guess, in terms of where do we intervene, how do we intervene, and then what are the what are the ramifications of that as well?
All right, that's a great question, Alex. Thanks a lot for bringing it to the discussion, and I think. One, I'm not really lately too clued up necessarily on the context around what's happening in Mozambique, and I can only speak from some of the issues that I know. And I think for me, the relationship between the Democratic Republic of Congo and South Africa is an interesting one, although I'm not too also much of an expert about it, but I made to understand that some of the issues, there is an alignment between South Africa's foreign policy towards the DRC and also refugees and migrants in the country and their own political economic interests in there. Particularly, I think there was an issue around Zuma, former President Jacob Zuma, with the elections that took place that were contested and the kind of side that Zuma chose to take. And it said, and there were a lot of internal contestations. And I think there is someone from the Congolese community here. I think there were clashes in Pretoria at the time, and a lot of protests around why South Africa had chosen to take the position it had taken on the issue. And I think there are also a lot of internal squabbles within the Congolese community itself around, sort of combatants and anti-combatants and whatnot. So, and I'm not necessarily, I think there are dedicated scholars who've worked on that issue specifically. But that is one case that shows us that there is an alignment between what South Africa likes to do in terms of foreign policy and the way it sort of responds to migration and how it treats migrants within the country. And also how in terms of securitizing and policing migrants, who then gets arrested and who gets criminalized. I think there was also a case of the alleged coup attempters that were arrested for trying to plot a coup, I think, in a meeting that they had in Limpopo, and eventually the issue just fall down because it was said that it was more of a somewhere the state had or police had conspired against these Congolese migrants. Then going back to the context I'm more familiar with, I think for me with the Zimbabwean case, I'm really interested in how the alignment between South Africa's foreign policy towards Zimbabwe and how it categorizes or how it responds to migrants at different times. During the Zimbabwean crisis, when Mugabe was still in power, the South African state policy towards Zimbabwe was characterized as a sort of, Mbeki was characterized as coddling the Zimbabwean state and not necessarily calling them out explicitly. And that was also said to be on the grounds of Zimbabwe's strategic position for South Africa's own economic interests and the Zimbabwe Bait Bridge, Zimbabwe South Africa corridor, and all sorts of relationships that exist. And I think that when it came to that happened, and that has also informed South Africa's response towards not wanting to call Zimbabwean migrants refugees or asylum seekers, because that would make the Zimbabwean state really look bad in the eyes of the world, right? And we see that continuity happening. And I think when it becomes more pronounced from the period of the global national unity, the government of national unity in Zimbabwe between the MDC and ZANU-PF, we see a sort of relationship between Zimbabwean migrants initially being seen as asylum seekers, then South Africa realizing, no, this is not going to work for us. Then the GNU happens. And then when by the time that Mugabe has left, there's really no trace of a Zimbabwean migrant being actually able to claim for asylum, right? And I think that goes back to how then with the notion that Mugabe is gone, that has also provided ammunition for the South African state to say there's no crisis in Zimbabwe, so there's no way that you could ever be an asylum seeker. So these are what I'm trying to say is that we see very expedient narratives emerging across the unfolding of the Zimbabwean crisis up until now. I don't think we see anything that is that does not align with that perspective, that there is a relationship between South Africa's foreign policy and how, and the last part is that also allows South Africa to fulfill its own domestic interests, because by not giving asylum and refugee protection to Zimbabweans, you're also getting to appease your voting urban poor who are really much not so much in favor of that kind of an approach.
Okay, great, thank you. So we're coming to the end, and so there's just one last question that I'm just gonna pose. Well, it's two questions, and it's from Dinga Sekwebu on Facebook. And the first is, who are the candidates for anti-migrant bloc outside of the state? And how are their actions and mobilization related to state initiatives? A big question. And his second question, which is one I think we might have to end on, is what should us as activists focus on around this issue? So there's two questions. The first is the candidates for anti-immigrant bloc outside of the state, and how are they related to actions and mobilize related to state initiatives? And what should we as activists focus on? Those are big.
Yeah, I didn't fully follow the first one. I can wimp out and answer the second one, if that helps. The thing I was thinking of, like, when we were talking around our research on COVID and responses to COVID, which I thought was interesting and maybe interesting to your members, was when we were speaking to like large NGOs or UN organizations, they obviously had a number of issues accessing populations, or they had issues with the population getting to the services. And then the discussion came to be more around sort of locally led initiatives, training and working with local populations to assist local people, sort of community-based approaches. And I thought that was a, you know, if you're trying to find some sort of positive or potential, you know, longer term improvement on services and provision for refugees and migrants, that is quite one way of looking at it. In relation to broader sort of xenophobic issues, I mean, we can definitely share a lot of the stuff that I said my colleague JP has written about, talking about sort of local community-led projects. And I can share some articles around that. That would be really interesting. There's a new book that came out this in the last few months called Brother, although the BR is in brackets, and I can share that link. But just as a warning, it's a photo and sort of essays, and it's amazing, but there's some pretty horrific photos. So just if it's gonna potentially trigger any sort of memories around xenophobic violence, then just, you know, be careful.
Great, thank you.
I'll share that now.
Thank you.
Can I also chip in here? I don't think I quite got the second question as well. So I would appreciate maybe a reframing, if possible. But yeah, I don't think I got it. I understood it.
Okay, so
I would also like to respond to the second question, but only maybe after you've done so, Alex.
So who are the candidates for an anti-migrant bloc outside of the state? And how are their actions and mobilization related to state initiatives? Is it that question?
Yeah, I don't think that I've really grasped it, or I might be able to respond to it. But is it about who's opposed to migration? Is it
besides? Yeah, I mean, there's definitely an anti-migrant narrative that is being fostered. Yeah. So for example, within the DA, for example, and in other areas, and how do those then link to what the state is also doing?
Oh, I think there has been, like, I think, thanks for the clarification. I think we know that there's been, in terms of political parties, like you're saying, that the DA has also been taking a more securitized approach and trying to say that migrants are, there should be more fortification of borders and our borders are being violated. And I think when we see the case, that being the case, when there's a lot of in parliament, when incidences such as the Bushiri scandal take place, that always, you know, such moments become an opportunity for this party to take that stance, which is also a bit, I find a bit contradictory, because for people who are sort of within a kind of who operate within a sort of neoliberal kind of framework, it hasn't been the case much that they would oppose they'll be standing opposed to migration. And then, but we see this is a very interesting contradiction where we, you know, actors like the EFF who are sort of hardliners then go ahead and say, no, migration is a good thing. You know, these are our brothers. And going back to the book that Nick has mentioned, Pan-Africanism, we are all equal. So it's a very fascinating kind of state of affairs where you would have expected these more sort of radical and these are not my words, but what others, you know, would have termed fascists, for example, because of their position. Not saying that I necessarily agree with those labels. So yeah, we do see that very interesting. So it is about interest, I think, at the end of the day, around what people are expecting to get out of it. I don't know what the DA or the EFF get out of it, but I do think that contradiction suggests that there is something happening there that maybe would be a matter of interest to people who are interested in learning more about the sort of party politics and stances on immigration. And then finally, then to respond to the second question, the question around activists, what are the lessons? I think we should be careful of essentializing sort of categories that essentialize people. We should be careful of essentializing migrants, essentializing women, essentializing children, essentializing in categories that then become inherently linked to vulnerability or lack of agency or the other way around. But in spaces such as the border that I just described, we find, you know, if you go in that space, or as has been the case with an activism perhaps that sees particular bodies, men, you know, women and children as more inherently vulnerable than men, you are bound to reproduce particular dangerous spaces because it's not necessarily the case that always plays out on the ground. You know, the men in these shelters are really having a rough time. And I think for many years, humanitarian actors have entered that space and it does embody some of those assumptions. And I'm not saying that it's happened deliberately or not. And finally, activists maybe need to find ways of, this is something that has been echoed by colleagues, that, you know, there needs to be ways of bringing together the struggles of locals and non-nationals. Surely there is a way to ground the precarity within this one framework, or a way to bring together these concerns, because so far, say, you know, talking about migrants as migrants and omitting perhaps internal other forms of mobility or movement, which is where mobility becomes important, has only served to divide and to alienate and in fact, people will say to you, why are you arguing for the rights of migrants only in a context where, you know, people are staying in informal settlements, people have not received their own social welfare, and they so happen to be citizens. So we need to find ways of bringing together these concerns and framing them within, you know, a framework of, this is not necessarily about individuals competing or contesting or fighting. It is about the bigger picture. It is about the neoliberal state. It is about distribution of capital, and it is about racial and class inequality.
Okay, I'm going to have to just stop us there. Thank you so much. Keep your cameras on. You know, it leads very well to this idea of working in poor solidarity, which is what you're talking about. That is going to be part of our next episode that I'm going to talk about in a second. But I just want to read something that was put on Facebook, also in response to this, by Pindi, about this question is very important, because arguably 2019 was the first time that anti-immigrant sentiment became legitimized and as an electoral campaign issue. The ANC, DA, and as big parties and other smaller parties all had messages about securing borders, etc., and the strain that migrants have on services. And I suspect this will be a platform for the local government elections when some of these smaller parties, such as Action SA, ATM, and local economic development and trading in townships will be highlighted as a municipal issue. So I think there's lots of work to do, as Pindi has pointed out. Dinga, we have no time, has just reminded us about the MK developments in KZN about the anti-immigrant sentiments and their politics and how that is playing out as legitimizing some of this idea of the threat, immigrant, the migrantist threat. So just in closing, I just would like to invite everyone here. Our next episode is on Tuesday at 4 o'clock. And this takes us back into this idea of working class solidarity historically. We will be looking at working class lessons on migration and how South Africa's first trade unions built cross-border solidarity. There we were talking to Henry D in conversation with other historians, because as we know, South Africa economy is a migrant labor economy. And so what can we learn about trade unions historically that has looked at working class solidarity across borders? And so that will be episode 2. So please join us on Tuesday via these same platforms, and that will be on Tuesday at 4 o'clock. And for more about how to RSVP, look at our Facebook page and our website. And I just would like to thank Nicholas and Kudakwashi very much. It's been really a fantastic learning experience for myself, and I'm sure for everyone. So thank you everyone for joining us, and goodbye.
Thank you.